transpire is that you can take a few questions and then you can just say your name and just actually identify yourself. And then just directly to any speaker that you want. So with that, I'll open it to the floor so anyone can talk. So maybe in front. Anyone else? Maybe I'll take three questions now.
Notion, much wider and different notion of multiculturalism, which people coming up and saying, well, in my tradition, in my religious tradition or in my ethnic tradition, okay, you look at sexuality this way, you look at social sexuality this way, and so on and so forth. That's how it's been happening in Singapore. It has its problems. So that, for example, the religious groups that are more well organized will then come up and say, well, you know, this is how.
That's the first big point, I said, the rarefication. Today we put it up as central and then we debate it from religious terms. So the rarefication has something to do with, some people even say it's Victorian values that we picked up along the way because of British colonialism. There are many claims as to why we rarefy. That's one. And then second thing is, I will come back to my kind of framework of looking at things, and that is a recuperation of the older ways by which we approach this issue. Without the Victorian values and without the religious hardening. I'll stop there because I'm not the expert on this, but I just suggest those are some ways by which you can unravel such a complex topic. I wouldn't be able to comment more, that's not my specialty.
Alright, so let's open it up to the floor so now that everyone's going to step in and I'll give you a second question. We'll start with something first.
Alright, so all of you, I think Lai Ah Eng talked about this a bit. How does the narrative of multiculturalism erase class in Singapore? That's something that a lot of, I get the idea, it's not something that's talked about very much. It's people are aware of it, but people don't really think about it. If they think in terms of race, but not so much class. So how do that get erased why? And I guess for Elaine, how does that affect who gets to be cosmopolitan and who doesn't? And the whole idea of cosmopolitanism is still there.
My question is on multiculturalism as in general. I mean, nowadays it's rise of intolerance and before, and one way to resolve it as opposite is tolerance. But I was wondering whether tolerance is the right way to go. Would that it bring more resentment instead? And what are your views
question, you can take one more.
I think the biggest hallmark of CNI conditioning in Singapore would be the Prime Minister's National Day rally speech. To all speakers, you think that how would you rate the Prime Minister's annual NDRS in terms of multiculturalism, good or bad? Would you keep it? How would you revamp it?
Can you repeat that? What is the Black Caucus?
Couldn't hear you just now. With regards to multiculturalism, the most important so-called tradition is the annual National Day rally speech by the Prime Minister of Singapore, in which he gives a speech in four different languages.
Of very diverse
tradition somehow has continued unquestionably. Whether it really works today, I don't know. I don't want to spend my time imagining whether it works, because I'll never be the Prime Minister. The question about tolerance, well, maybe do this one first about class. I think you are right to some extent that that when people have an emphasized mindset, they leave out other elements, especially the important one of the class. But I think there are analyses out there. People actually quite cleverly put these together, the three together, class, so-called race, and gender, become very complex analysis. So that we're not talking about, we can talk about poor Chinese, we can talk about poor Malays, okay, we'll talk about the poor, right? But inevitably, I think this is a challenge, how to have a very more nuanced and complex way of combining these dimensions and not say this is more important than this. Because you can have a very classist approach and deny other elements as well. So I think it's more important to be able to read the situation and the context well and to be able to have a complex analysis that combines different dimensions together. I happen to, for example, come from a meeting this afternoon and we're looking at the poor who live in HDB rental and interim. Okay? It's poor, yeah. Class is the main thing. But when you break it down, you have to look at subgroups. And some of the cultural groups are Malay, it's Malay poor. Now, to what extent, how far you want to deal with it as a Malay poor rental housing issue, and to what extent you want to deal with this as simply an issue of poverty, you've got to use, it's a judgment call, you know, and it's also an experience. When you have to use cultural resources, when you use national resources, combine the two in very clever ways. I think this is what is difficult about, like I said, difficult about diversity. And the problem about tolerance, it is quite cliche to say tolerance is not enough. Yet, a lot of research shows that tolerance is one basic condition, at least. And then you qualify that and say, tolerance without abuse, tolerance without exclusion. And I would agree that it's not enough. I think that it can actually be quite it's one-sided, okay? But I think in reality, if you look at human histories in many cases, okay, it's very complex. It can range from the most intolerant to the tolerant, to the most appreciative, to the most integrative, assimilative, whatever, okay? All the processes are historically grounded, contextualized, so it's very hard to say that alone won't do. Yes, that alone won't do, but that must be one condition to be the right. But it's not enough. It's not enough. But I want to say something about cosmopolitanism. I think that the way things, the debate and the issues of cosmopolitanism, how it has evolved in Singapore is actually quite extreme. Number one is raised by the government. Suddenly it tells you, you have to be cosmopolitan. Right? Before that, it's okay to be just Singapore. So the debate is a very artificial one. I would in fact argue that we are already very cosmopolitan. You know, some of us have traveled a lot. Our parents traveled to come here, have worked with different groups of people from different backgrounds and so on and so forth. Don't forget, migration here and immigration and migrations in the region have been very complex. homophobic, okay, racist, is because of the conditions of immigration that have taken place. Very massive, very fast, high speed. Nobody can that easily. Okay? And so people feel that they have been displaced. Anybody who feel that they have been displaced would articulate their abilities in certain ways. Okay? I would say that yes, there are individuals out there who are very racist, anti-Asian, but I think we don't have an organized movement. Not yet. I think Gilbert Gold is not organized. it is true that in Europe, for example, the extreme nationalism is organizing. In Singapore, are we grouping and organizing? I don't know. Sure, the tensions are out there on the internet. Okay. The fighting is really out there. The tension is also very easy on the locals. Okay. Because they express themselves out there. With all that hate speech, all the unhappiness, all the comment. And usually the people are angry with all this, right? But it's harder, as I said, to find out how this category of cosmopolitans, of immigrants, how they feel about being here as well. You know? You also see very racist comments. You also see very ethnocentric comments, right? I think in terms of the tilt, okay, in scholarship especially, we have been very sympathetic overall in migration studies for different categories of immigrants. Okay. I'm not talking about just single, I'm talking about worldwide, because it tends to be displaced people, refugees, blah blah blah, right? And rightly so, and they have rights. But I think it's the sure focus on this, and we have not looked at the British old ladies who are very upset with how their town has changed overnight. We immediately tar them as racist. But there's something there maybe we didn't look at deep enough. You know, some of the most vocal critics of immigrants are your ethnic minorities in Singapore. So what are you going to say? Why are you going to say they are racist? It's double racism? Okay, some people say that. But I think we really got to dig very deep and unpack this.
Maybe one last round of questions and then for the speakers, and after that we can also answer some questions. So one, two, and one more? Anyone? Or two more? Okay, then. Okay, three then.
Just comment about multiculturalism and multi-racial, because I seem to remember that when we first started talking about multiculturalism, we were probably the second country in the world to refer to ourselves as multicultural after Canada. But there was a stage in the 90s, I think, if I recall, Lee Hsien Loong especially said that we are not multicultural, but we are multiracial. Anybody remember that? I remember it. and I can see why they were moving away from multiculturalism to multiracialism. Anyway, that's a point I just wanted to remind people, or remind myself. But I want to thank Living with Myths, and with all the speakers, and particularly Imran. I learned so much about Malay history and Malay contribution to Singapore. And that image you showed of all the, Kuik Klang and the seaport there, I didn't know anything about that, you know? And I don't know how many of us knew about that, and how much of that history is that being recorded? Is that in the Malay Cultural Center, for instance? How can we then bring back? I know that this is a way of doing it, but those of us who are here are mostly converts, actually, who want to hear about these stories and want to learn more about our history, but how do we then extend it beyond the converts, you know? Because I think it's part of our history.
Hello, my name is Sharon. My question actually really builds on what Constance said. I think the academia that you guys presented a power to us tonight is inherently sort of activist in nature. There are obviously problems with the CMIO model and how we're thinking about race, how we ourselves are often unconsciously racialized. So my question is, what does effective activism look like? Where do we go from this conceptual understanding of what we heard to be?
I just want to thank the three speakers for very interesting talks. Two questions. So my goal is, once Imran's talk. Because what really kind of stood out to me in the images that you showed, particularly in Lang's, was it seemed to me that if you look at the past and present practices of academia, it seemed that ironically that the British officials were more ready to acknowledge difference and not flatten than saying, you know, Singaporean values and can why appear to some difference but then reduce and put people and space particular types of categories. So I'm wondering whether you can comment on that initial and your source. The follow-up question, and that is actually just a lot of speakers you're interested in asking, because I always kind of feel that multiculturalism within it is always a new potential, where the point is to recognize cultural difference. But as we recognize difference, we inevitably, as I mentioned, in the minefield or the danger of misrecognizing it. You know, you put somebody in the territory, in a bit you try to say that, oh, you know, to somebody who's culturally different from me, oh, you must be part of this bigger category. Oh, we need to hear your voice. Then you have the kind of movement that take place. So beyond this, what are your thoughts about moving beyond this kind of fairly, you know, static CMI model?
Sounds a bit strange to say this, but it is in the MHC, and it's largely because the research that I showed was done quite early on, and there's a lot that I've been doing since then, and that early version is what I fed into some of the MHC galleries. It's very limited because, you know, a museum has to do a lot more than just talk about urban histories, but it's somewhere there, it's more or less there. But maybe I would take this opportunity to ask to take a journey, you know, a mental journey. Go back. I mentioned it fleetingly earlier. This whole thing about cosmopolitanism and the anxiety of a home being inundated by newcomers. Well, I think if I speak for my late grandmother, whose own grandparents were born here and whose grandparents' parents came to Singapore, and I think really early, but she's of half Bugis and Bavarian descent. So she's obviously an immigrant, you know what I mean? But in her perspective, she was here first. So then, and also as a person from this archipelago, they've been used to them being the majority. Just put it this way, just like the Chinese in Singapore would be used to being the majority. Okay, just picture this. So then you see under British rule, the racial balance changing so that you become a minority. So just think of it. Whatever we're talking about today, cosmopolitanism, the fear, the threat, your home being inundated by outsiders, the so-called Malayo-Nusantarans felt it first. And this happened, you can read accounts of the 1830s, there are three actually, personal accounts of the 1830s by Malays, the broad category, talking about this inundation of what they perceive as outsiders into a British rule port. Don't forget, it only became a British rule port in 1824. Not 1819, whatever you believe is not quite accurate. It was a tripartite rule, so home and the resident. It was only British rule in 1824, so that's the thing. And then again in the 1890s and 1930s, so two more times. So three times Malays felt this threat. Yeah, which the Chinese today ironically talk about. I'm not saying all Chinese, but a lot of Chinese in Singapore talk about how the Chinese from China are different from us. You know, just imagine if you're both speaking Mandarin, or you can speak Mandarin, see a difference. What about the people of the archipelago? who saw that this was a colonial rule policy to increase Chinese immigration. And as long as we as Singaporeans cannot talk about this openly, we won't be on the same level as, say, the reconciliation that we can see in New Zealand or Australia. I'm not likening our situation to theirs. It's completely different, but there are parallels. We cannot talk about this openly yet, because for some reason we are afraid to talk about it openly. And I think what you were saying is that double racism with minorities feel like that. And for us, it's ironic. Seriously. For us, it's, yeah, what are y'all talking about? And then you emphasize Singaporeans by writing in Mandarin and saying, was your Ching Chang Sing Singaporean? I mean, like, what the hell is that? Yeah, what the hell is that? Maybe it takes a minority speaker to say this. Why is it that? Maybe we don't have empathy as Singaporeans. We see Singapore as Chinese. First and foremost, how many of you think of that? That's kind of strange. So we have not reached that level of cosmopolitanism. I don't talk about commercial cosmopolitanism, traveling cosmopolitan, but seeing this as a multi-ethnic country is not, we are not there yet, I'm sorry. We are definitely not there yet. It's nothing to do with class or what we've got to do with. And that's why during my presentation, if you talk about activism, my activism is, look around you, it's still there. The evidence is just about to fade from popular memory, but it's still there. Some of it, unless it's been taken away. So it is largely to our awareness of things that are still around. They're barely, not even 200 years old yet. None of them are 200 years old yet, maybe forgotten. I mean, those that are not yet demolished. They all speak of very complex interweaving of cultures. Nothing to do with highfalutin notions of cosmopolitanism. They were all localized, but of different backgrounds. Why can't we talk about it like that? That's our identity. It's not being parochial at all, because these people were not parochial. They came from all sorts of diverse places. And they had to live together in this colony. So there's something in history, as a historian, always when we're around this. History has value, it's not useless. Because it really has value. So that's the activism in the world. It's around us. And all of you can talk about it, it's not just me. I just try to open the floodgates. Because once you see it through those lenses, you can look at the landscape in a different way. So it's really, you know, the landscape as text. This is a geography here. The landscape as text. Not an architecture, but we also look at it that way. Because the building is also a text. That sort of thing. I forgot
the maps.
Yeah. So I think, yeah, you're right. Actually, that's a fascinating question. Because the British were definitely one step removed from local communities. But they definitely went out of their way to understand things. Because, you know, those words that I showed, those were done by British scholars who recorded. That was by the one I quoted. So there were many others, in Firmstone, for example. There were a number of scholars who did this kind of documentation because we were interested to know how all the different groups in Singapore referred to places and did not use the English labels, the English language labels. Yeah. So in a way, we, strangely enough, prefer to use the colonial labels. It has to be, you were asking how come, right? Yeah, I wonder that, I mean, I could give a quick answer that we are neo-colonialists in our mindset, they have anxiety about being whatever, you know, that we don't want to appeal to the vernacular and so on. I don't know. But part of it, I tried to explain it in two ways. One could be that this really has to do with the dominance of branding for tourism, which we have carried away with. We use the branding we use for tourism to teach. So we now teach children in social studies that this is Chinatown, this is. So it's kind of strange, and these terms were fixed by STP 1984. So, yeah, that's one source. The other way is if you read, for example, Brown and many other scholars, this is ethnic management of ethnicity in Singapore. I mean, that's another ball game altogether. It's a little different from the tourism bit, which is about simplification for marketing. It appears because of simplification, it's too complex. You don't have a theme. You let theme the environment, you want something complex and messy. You know, it's, for some of us as scholars, we say it's interesting, but for most people out to enjoy it, they don't want that. So that's one. That sounds innocent enough, but it's not truly innocent. It's tourism. The other one has to do with a perhaps more sinister management of ethnicity. And part of this has to do with encoding, whether we succumb to it, conscious of it or not, encoding our kind of opinion, if you like, of the role and place of different groups in Singapore's history, and therefore whether they did a lot or did nothing. To put it bluntly, you know, consequences and management of ethnicity as components in national identity. So those are the two. It's a bit away from the maps, but I think it's really
I came back to Singapore about 3 years ago. Before that, I was overseas for about 7 years. And this time coming back to Singapore, what worries me is the naturalization of nation and belonging. When we know that Singapore is an immigrant society from the very start, as Imran was saying, but yet we use this national, the myth of a national story to advance certain kinds of exclusions. And I hesitate to use the term racism because I don't think it's as clear-cut as racism. Because when we think about racism, we boil it down to certain ethnic categories. In that case, how do you account for the tensions between Singaporean Chinese and mainland Chinese, or the tensions between the new South Asian immigrants and Singaporean Indians? So I think that the CMI model has failed us to some extent in terms of coping with these kind of more complex divisions that's taking place or becoming more apparent in Singapore now. And I feel that the camp that advances this idea of naturalizing territorial belonging is not taking into account how the nation, how the national story has been constructed for us in terms of managing populations through using certain types of categorizations. So I feel uncomfortable with simplifying it to racism and xenophobia, because I think it's far more complex than that. Now, in terms of then what is the activism that we can bring to it? I think for me, since now my life really centers around my work, so it's through my teaching. So through my teaching, telling the students some of these problematizing the ideas about nation, about race, about multicultural, multiracial model that we have, I think it's seeding these ideas and making them aware of other possibilities, the things that we have discussed here today. But I think outside of the classroom as well, and that's why I talk about biographical connections and affinity. Because as Ayn was saying, it's really a minority of people who express very strong anti-immigration sentiments. And the reverse is true as well. It's a minority of immigrants who are very philosophers and their critiques of Singapore and Singaporeans. But if we meet such people in our everyday interactions, we can speak up. So maybe this doesn't have to do with ethnicity, but for example, one of my pet peeves is on the MRT train, you see the seats that are reserved for the elderly, and sometimes you get people who are clearly very able to be sitting down, and when the elderly person comes up, they don't have a seat. And so, me being a able Singaporean, I will actually go and say, excuse me, this is reserved for the elderly. And normally the person is embarrassed enough to pick up a seat, although I've encountered people who just simply stay there. But my point is this, similarly when we hear people invoking attitudes that project social prejudice that is unfair, we can question those attitudes through communication. And I think earlier we talked about tolerance and I mentioned respect. And I think going beyond that, it's about communication. Right? It's about communication in our everyday circles and also with the immigrants that we meet to try and foster a more mutual understanding. So the communication is critical as well in how we think of ourselves as Singaporeans, because as we have clearly said from today's discussion in Q&A, we're still figuring out what it means for CMIO categories to live together in all its complexity. And then on top of that, we have these new immigrant diversity. So this kind of dialogue, whether at an everyday level, in a public setting, or at the policy level, I think it's critical in terms of thinking through what makes us a nation.
So much, Maria. I don't know what I've lost my train of thought listening to you. I think your point about so how do we do this is very difficult. I think we just
vision of things to come, other than, you know, politicians will give us a grand vision. Yeah. We also have some grand visions in terms of clear principles. Now nobody questions equality. Right? Nobody can tell you you're inferior because you're black or brown. You'll be shot to death, right? Which is a great, great advance in the world. So I think we are talking about advancing. Things, as well as small things in life, in my everyday life. And I think that I can only think in terms of answering your question, what, for example, I think I can do. Okay? Don't forget, I did think about how I grew up. I grew up in Malaysia. I saw a race riot, an ethnic riot, and then died in that riot. I'm going to write about this. What was another seminar we talk about business in Singapore. Okay? You think, okay, what can you that shape that changed my view about relations and so forth. But what can we do now? I think about documenting those riots with lessons learned at the end of it. Yeah? I want to document like Imran has done or beginning to do in the past what the maps can do to you, you know, can change your view about places. I think we need to do a lot of those things. We need to come together for a lot of those things of the past, rereading the past, revisiting the past, and see how it's actually much more diverse than what is given to us now. It's also to critique cosmopolitanism, but actually some of us are saying more cosmopolitanism than before, maybe, and we are already very, very cosmopolitan. So don't give this to us anymore. By the way, as an aside, I think the cosmopolitan bit in the simple context is very difficult, complicated by the fact that it comes together with this other label called foreign talent, which has been very insulting as interpreted by some people. Foreign talent equals better talent equals locals not enough talent. Equals not good talent. It's like those ways of looking at things. So when it becomes like that, it's very hard to try to bring people together, which is, I'm just saying, it's not possible. But I think we've got to shed and unpack all this. Then we can come to better or more equal terms. Don't talk about foreign talent to me. Unequally talented. So let's drop that foreign talent, local talent labels, for example, and shift to something better. Yeah? So maybe as an anthropologist, I like to say we really need a lot of documentation and then work around it to do exciting new projects. And I think, like this one, you know, it's very hard. I think we couldn't have had a discussion like this, I don't know, 3-4 years ago. We try, but it's not so big, it's not so generalized, much generalized. This should be part of our culture. This should be part of our culture. So build on this. And then maybe we'll get a better idea of what is next. Yeah. And arrive closer to whatever vision. But I think the vision will always change.
So one thing you can do is to propose a project on race. Project 1500. So thank you very much for your very kind attention, and let's thank all the speakers.